We've got a great show ahead of us. We're going to talk great events at the Lakeland Center, great events at the city of Auburndale. We're also going to talk men's basketball at Southeastern University. Stick around, everybody, for this week's edition of Sports Central. Everybody, welcome back to Sports Central. Neal, Duncan alongside Hank Longo. And it's probably been 2 years since you and I have done this show together.
I know. This is a special show.
Yeah, after this, let's see if we can go 2 more years. Just kidding.
Well, and
we already started.
We got to say thanks so much to the Hampton Inn of Winter Haven for sponsoring this fun event that's taken 2 years in the making.
They sponsored the whole 2 years? Well, Hank, this is a great time of year, and as we've had a number of events that have just recently occurred, we're getting to the holiday season. Yeah. There's a number of events going on in the community, and then once we turn the calendar, we take off and go.
Oh yeah, there's all kinds of things going on. It's a fun time of the year, a festive time of the year, and we have a very special guest that has a lot of these events happening in our county, and Mr. Tony Camarillo from the Lakeland Center, the director. Tony, great having you with us.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Appreciate the opportunity.
Well, the first time we had you on the show, yeah. I think it was Chris, and who else was?
Chris and... Neal, no, it wasn't you, Neal.
I don't know who. Maybe it was just Chris. But they were nice to you. No, I'm just kidding. We're going to be nice to you as well. But first tell us about, 6 months now?
Roughly 7 months.
7 months?
Finished
you've
up
been
my
to
seven
Lakeland
month.
Center?
Yeah, love
what,
it. It's
what have
great.
You found about the Lakeland Center? And what unique offerings does the Lakeland Center have that attracts events to that facility?
Well, I think it's certainly a wonderful space for just any type of event, for meetings. We have a wonderful arena. I think that our central location is certainly appealing. We're poised right in the middle of the state, easy to get to from just about anywhere in the state. So I think that we are able to serve the public well that way. We're a unique opportunity. As I said, we have the arena, we have a convention center along with the theater. And we are, very flexible, and I think we can do just about anything.
Well, the theater, you bring in great entertainment. I know there's some great entertainment that's coming, like this weekend. You've got some going on. Tell us about that.
Yeah, actually, tonight we have Cirque Holidays. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow we have a comedy show. Last Comic Standing from the NBC show.
So this is a live show today, everybody. So you want to get there on the 14th. If you watch this show today, you might miss a great event at the Lakeland
Center. Yeah, we're very lucky to have the show there. We have the finalists that will be performing, as well as four of the runner-ups for Last Comic Standing.
I watched the show. So it's a fun show to watch.
Yeah, it's
These
a great
guys
show.
Guys are hilarious.
Yeah, it's a
and
great
the
show.
Gals. I mean, they've got great talent on the show.
Yeah. You apparently haven't taken anything away from the show, but... Just kidding.
Maybe tonight, maybe tomorrow night, you can get some pointers.
Well, talk about events like that or special shows like that, because these are really talented individuals, and they may have not been the winner, but all too often these reality shows, you see some of the ones that didn't actually win end up being the bigger star than who actually did win.
Yeah, go on to great careers.
Yeah, and I think what's great about that is we're bringing them right here to Polk County and into Lakeland, and it's a great opportunity for people to see people that are on a national stage right now. And you're absolutely right, they may not be the winner this year, but you might see them down the line being on a sitcom or something like that.
Yeah, and when you get up to that level on that show, you have really got to be funny. I mean...
It's a national search. They don't just pull these people off the street. These guys are pretty seasoned, but they might not have hit it big time yet.
Yeah.
So I think that's a great opportunity.
I mean, from what I've seen, this is what they do. They're professional comedians, and they're just maybe looking for
that big pop
that'll just, take them up to the next level.
And then we're part of that now. So we're putting them on a stage. We're giving them the opportunity at the Lakeland Center to get in front of this everybody here in Lakeland.
Well, we do want to mention, because you told us in the pre-show conversation that this is a family-friendly venue, but this event, it's an open mic. Maybe you need to be over 18 to
For sure. I think it's probably we recommend that if somebody under the age of 18 is there with somebody over the age of 18, just so that you can make that judgment call if it gets a little a little blue for you.
A little too far down the road for some people's taste. Talk to us about the gun show.
Well, the gun show's coming back, and again, it's timely because this weekend, this is November 14th and 15th, we have the Florida Gun Show, and it's an annual event for us, and I think it's a great opportunity. It's certainly is very highly attended, and we get a lot of people that come out and enjoy the gun show. Not only is it you can purchase guns, there's a lot of memorabilia that they have.
Educational classes.
Absolutely, educational classes, and they do concealed carry classes, which I think is really important. So we have that show, and we also have the original gun show later in the year, and both of them, you know, really stress that. You know, it's gun safety is really important to them, and they have classes that help people out with that.
Now we have the arena. This is one of the big things that goes on at the Lakeland Center. There's so many different venues there. You've got the theater, you got the convention center, and then you have the arena, and it's the time of the year for the public ice skating.
Yeah, public ice skating. It's a great opportunity for the months of November, December, January. We have public skating. It's about 15,000 people come through the door for that event. We really focus on holidays. We'll have a couple of days during Thanksgiving holiday, the 24th through the 29th. We also have extended through Christmas and New Year, December 20th through January 3rd. Tickets go on sale. They're on sale now. Adults is $10. Kids are $9. And if you bring your own skates, you pay $8. And if you bring a group of 10 or more, you get $1 off. So I think that's a
So when
Good
you come, you
groups.
Don't have to worry about skates. You come, you pay for your ticket, and you have skates available,
skates
and you're
included.
Off and sliding.
Yeah, we actually even go down to toddler size skates to get the little skates like that. Hockey skates for those hockey aficionados who want to just get around there and live their dream, as a Chicago Blackhawk or something
there
like
it
that.
Is. I didn't take
Detroit,
long to work
Detroit
in
Red Wing.
Or the Lightning, I mean, local here.
Of course.
But you,
of course.
You know, Hank was talking about, and I think you were alluding to it earlier, the diversity of what the Lakeland Center can offer to events coming in. We talked about the last comic standing, we've talked about ice skating, and then you guys have an event coming up called the Tea and Symphony. Tell us a little bit about that, and as you can see, our viewers, there's something for everyone.
Exactly. The Imperial Symphony Orchestra uses Lakeland Center as its home. Yuki Theater is where they perform. I was fortunate enough to see their start the season off a couple weeks back, and it's amazing. If you don't haven't had the opportunity to experience it, you should, and you could do that through the Tees. And it basically it's an opportunity to get a little more close to some of the performers, and certainly to the maestro, Mark Thielen, and he's able to. What he really wants to do is bring it a little bit closer. He expresses how the music's produced, gives a little history about the composers, and it's just an opportunity for guests to really experience it from a different level and get a little bit closer to it.
But a little more educational
and definitely.
Can see more of what really goes on in the symphony just besides watching them perform.
Yeah, and you'd really be surprised if you hadn't had a chance to get to see it. Very entertaining, extremely entertaining, very talented people we have here.
And ages, this is for all ages. It's a great learning opportunity for young people.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, if you're a Polk County student, you get in for free. So I think that's a great opportunity for kids from around the area to experience it, and that definitely for all ages. And when you educate your kids on some of the that music, I think it's just the right thing to do. Symphony music's awesome.
And we were talking about as the calendar rolls over, a couple of the signature events at the Lakeland Center. Events have been there a long time. Would be the rodeo first. When is that? And then the boys and girls state finals coming back to the Lakeland Center. So talk about those two events and how they're good. For the Lakeland Center.
Yeah, rodeo is moving into January for us. They switched their dates a little bit, but this rodeo is the largest and longest running rodeo in the state of Florida. And these cowboys and cowgirls are competing for places in the Nationals, which takes place in Las Vegas later in the year. It's a great family event as well. We were very happy that they continue to come back year after year. Generates about 10,000 visitors to the Lakeland Center, which is great, great for us. It also is very entertaining. You get the rodeo, which is certainly the key component. But this year again, Animal Planet, Gator Boys, Jimmy. Jimmy Riffle.
Little gator wrestling going on. It's always entertaining.
It's just an added attraction. I think it's something that that the people really enjoy when they come mm-hmm. to see the rodeo.
You know, what makes you want to do that? I mean,
well, I'm new to Florida. I haven't gotten into gator wrestling yet.
He has no idea.
I live on the lake. I've got them in my backyard, and never once have I really wanted to run down there and wrestle with one.
Well, if you decide to do that last night, we'll send the crew down there to film it.
Yeah, it could be possibly something we look into in the future. But I think having the performers that are on TV and people really are interested in seeing them. There's meet and greet involved, so mm-hmm. I think that it's just an added excitement and generates some extra attendance for the rodeo.
And then you have the monkeys.
Yeah, there's another group that's down there. The ghost riding team. It's called. It's a group of dogs, some collie, border collies, that have monkeys astride on them. And they wrangle up some sheep. I don't know how it's done exactly. They said you have to see it to believe it.
To believe it, yeah.
So,
I've seen it numerous years, and I don't know that it ever gets old. It is fantastic to watch those monkeys working those dogs who are working the sheep. It's pretty neat.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, that's talent. That's talent. And then, of course, we had Florida High School basketball championships mm-hmm. at Lakeland Center again. We're really excited to have the boys and the girls championships. And the opportunity for us to host that here in Lakeland is great and bring a lot of people to the area to visit us. There's going to be 24 games for each championship. The new this year is there's a flat fee for the whole day, where they've had sessions before.
Yeah.
So it's a flat fee for the whole day, so you can stay throughout and watch all the games, or stay for your particular team, maybe come and. And do that.
It's great basketball. I mean, if you like basketball, to see all the young talent that we've got in the state of Florida and the local talent that we have, it's a treat to watch these young kids play the game.
I'm excited. I'm hopeful that some Polk County teams make it that far, and I don't want to jinx anything, but we're hoping for that.
I think
we're here to host everybody from the state for sure.
Anyone that's watched this program knows where my allegiance lies with the Bartow Yellow Jackets, but we hope that there's representation throughout all divisions from Polk County, because it is neat to have that home court advantage, if you
Absolutely.
Will. And the economic impact is not just the teams, it's not just the fans or the school in general, but you also have all levels of college basketball coaches and scouts that
coming
are here recruiting
watch
and watching
and look at these kids.
It's
yeah.
not just football that there's great talent or baseball, but also basketball here in Polk County and the state of Florida. So November 30th, Mamma Mia?
Yeah, Mamma Mia November 30th. Neal Sedaka on December 11th. An Irish Christmas on December 22nd. Just a couple of other things that we have on plan for the Lakeland Center. But I would encourage you, if you're interested, go to lakelandcenter.com and we can show you everything we have to offer.
Well, Tony, we appreciate your time, and
thank you.
We look forward to a great, long, successful journey with these events. And
awesome.
I know your team's already working on the Miss Florida event.
Absolutely.
That's a big
Very
one coming
excited
to Lakeland
about that.
Center.
I'll be driving her in the Christmas parade in Lakeland.
Perfect. Oh, so fantastic. If you want to see Tony and see Miss Florida, go to the Lakeland Christmas Parade.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, Tony, thank you so much. Well, we got some footage here of the USSSA Turkey Trot. This is in the past, but the future event is November 22nd and 23rd. Check out this action. Hank and Neal will be right back here on Sports Central.
The Pinellas Park Punishers, we just won 2-1 out here at the Christina Park. Girls, take it away.
We'll be right back. we're Bartow Intimidators 14 and under. We've been together about a year, and we are looking to try to go to Chattanooga, Tennessee in the summer of 2011 to play in the World Series. We've been on a roll here lately, last few tournaments. We've took home a first and 2 seconds. So we're doing pretty good.
Welcome back to Sports Central. Neal Duncan alongside Hank Longo, and some good footage there of the USSSA Turkey Trot.
Yeah.
Of course, softball has been one of those bread and butter events a long time here in Polk County. And speaking of bread and butter, we got a sponsor.
Yes, we do. A big thank you to Harry's Old Place for the second segment. And now,
did you see what I did there?
I live on the lake that Harry's Old Place is on, so I can actually boat over to Harry's Old Place for dinner and not have
so
to
it's dinner and a show.
Dinner and a show, yeah.
There you go.
It's fantastic. Well, alrighty. Right along, and our next guest, Mr. Duncan.
We talked to Tony about the upcoming events at the Lakeland Center. And, you know, in the open, Hank, we talked about how blessed we are. Not only do we have great weather here in Central Florida's Polk County, but we have great venues, we have great municipalities who put on terrific events. Yeah. And Larry Helms is here with the city of Auburndale with the Parks and Recreation Department. And Larry, welcome to the show, and thanks for coming on.
Thanks for having me.
Well, you guys have got a unique event coming up.
Yeah.
What is it, where is it, and how many years have you been doing it?
The event we have coming up is CityCon. This is our second year doing it. Just a real brief description of it. It's kind of focused on comics, sci-fi, horror, pop culture, all of those things kind of included into one. We wanted to do something a little different, and we wanted to bring something to the area that we hadn't really seen a lot of, and wanted to kind of a signature event for the city of Auburndale. So we did it last year in January. Really successful for a first year event, so we're working on our second one now.
Well, I went to the Comic-Con last year, and it is definitely a unique, enjoyable experience. They have all these comic book characters dressed up, which makes it fun because it just adds to the atmosphere and the entertainment. And who is the big hairy one from Star Wars?
Oh, Chewbacca.
He was there.
And, which there's about to be a new movie, a new Star Wars movie come out. Yeah.
And they had the car from Back in the Future there. Just a lot of neat, fun things to entertain yourself with.
Yeah, we try to make it really interactive. That's the difference between ours and some of the larger cons that you find in Orlando and Tampa. This is a lot of hands-on stuff. Kind of keeping that small town feel to it, and it should be a great event again this year. We've got a lot of surprises
it's
in store.
Kind of wild watching all these characters walking around while you're there. It just is a unique experience. It really is fun.
Yeah, and I think the cool part about it is the technology. Today's technology has really reinvented the whole comic and animated movies and what they're able to do. So it's like a renaissance of that industry, and we're really seeing the benefits in downtown Auburndale. And I'm guessing that the reason you guys wanted to bring that event down there is the city of Auburndale has done a terrific job in beautifying that downtown that downtown area.
Yeah, and that was the idea behind it. We wanted a truly downtown event, and we get to make use of not only our rental facilities, but the parks, our historic Baynard House, kind of all encompassed into one area. And it's really neat because it's not that you're stuffed in a large one convention center all day. You can you go in to see the vendors and buy your books or buy items from different people, and you go to another where you see panel discussions. Then we'll have interactive areas in another building, and then just things scattered throughout the park where you can really kind of, it's multi-sensory, and if the weather holds up, it's a great day.
Yeah. How can people get information, or how much are tickets, or is there a cost to attend, that kind of information?
There is a cost. They can find all of that information, AuburndaleFL/CityCon, or they can go to the CityCon Facebook page, just Google Facebook CityCon. Okay. All of that information is there. You can pre-purchase all access passes right now. Day of, tickets will be sold the day of the event. We'll be selling them, and that's January 22nd and 23rd.
is the actual date of the event. It's January 22nd, 23rd. Mm-hmm. So you can go to, what was the website one more time?
AuburndaleFL.com. Okay. And just search CityCon.
CityCon. Okay.
So you got a little time to prepare to make it to this event.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And as you were saying, a lot of people come dressed up. That's the attendees doing that. That's not us putting that part on. That's the people coming.
And we got the Star Wars characters. We had the Ghostbusters there, and it's just kind of bizarre watching these people walking around.
It's a very
it's kind of like the neighborhood I'd like to be living in all the time.
A lot of participation.
All these fun people wandering around. More fun stuff going on in December.
Oh yeah, you know, we're into the season now, so we've got our Breakfast with Santa that's coming up December 5th. That's 9 to 11 a.m. at our Civic Center. We also have the Havendale Christmas Parade December 4th, and then backing up one more day, December 3rd, the Christmas tree lighting in downtown Auburndale. That'll be 5 to 8 p.m., so we'll have a whole slice of the holidays right there at one time.
Fantastic.
You're talking about the Havendale Christmas Parade. That is a combination between Winter Haven and Auburndale,
That's in conjunction
right?
with Winter Haven and the city of Auburndale, yeah.
So, of course, you got the Lakeland Parade and the Bartow and the other communities, but it's kind of neat to see two communities come together in that area because, you know, for a long time, you didn't know whether you left Winter Haven and were Auburndale or Auburndale and Winter Haven. And of course, you know, the residents know that, but it's amazing how that whole area has grown up and neat to see two communities coming together.
Yeah, it's kind of nice because it's so continuous there between Auburndale and Winter Haven now, and especially on Havendale where the parade takes place, that it is a nice blend of the two cities coming together and working.
Now, when they have the parade, do they shut down Havendale Boulevard?
They do. It usually shuts down, if I'm not mistaken, about 5:30.
Okay.
I don't have all of the information on that, but I believe it's about 5:30 when they shut down.
And how long does the parade last for, you know, people that are using Havendale Boulevard that all of a sudden?
Depending on the size of the parade, it varies. I think it's usually open by about 9 p.m. Parade starts at 7. It runs from Spring Haven Retirement Community up to, I believe, right at 42nd Street there.
Very good.
Well, we talked about, you know, and I think you made a great point earlier talking about the downtown Auburndale area, because I think it's easy right now to be caught up in all the great things Auburndale has done with the Lake Myrtle Sports Park and recruiting of events there, the huge economic impact in conjunction with the Polk County Board of County Commissioners and Tourism Sports Marketing, as well as the Florida Youth Soccer Association. But it's easy to get caught up and think, oh, Auburndale, Lake Myrtle. Well, the downtown area has had just as much attention talking about the Cindy Hummel
the tennis center.
Talk about that a little bit.
We renovated our tennis courts. Used to be right in the downtown city park. Mm-hmm. We kind of had this idea to make that back into park space and really make a beautiful downtown park, which was accomplished. In doing that, we had to move the tennis courts. They're slightly over, you know, if you're looking at it, over to the left now, but a beautiful tennis facility, one of the only public clay court facilities in the county. Just came together really well, lots of participation there. We invite anybody. We have one of the only quick start courts in the county.
What is a quick start?
That is an initiative by the USTA to kind of get the younger kids playing tennis again. It's basically a size down court with smaller rackets, and essentially it's a foam ball rather than the regular tennis ball. It slows down play a lot, so it's really good for getting the basics.
Gives an opportunity to hit the ball and get a rally.
Absolutely, going. It's a good slowed down way for them to learn the game of tennis.
Very interesting.
All right. Well, we can't talk about City of Auburndale, and I just mentioned it, Lake Myrtle. There's some construction going on at Lake Myrtle. Of course, Polk County, home to the Central Florida Collegiate Invitational, rust mat baseball, if you will. Over 220 plus college teams spring train here in Polk County, and a majority of that, of course, some of going on Winter Haven, but a majority of that will be going on at Lake Myrtle. And there was five fields, baseball fields there. Now, what are we looking at?
We're looking at having nine early spring 2016. So we'll be able to host a lot more games and bring in those bigger tournaments, and it'll all be on that one site. So we're excited about it.
Now, literally the $1 million question: is it on schedule?
As far as I know. don't
call Cody
don't,
McGee,
don't,
right?
Yeah. Call our director else. On that one.
You know, it's amazing though, just what a fantastic facility this has grown into, and that, you know, you could probably add four or five more fields to it and keep them booked up, just the way these events are growing and growing. And to have all these teams recruited during the winter, all these college teams that come down and play, is just fantastic.
Oh, yeah, it's a great benefit, not only to us and the county in general for the economic impact, but for the teams that are in these areas that, you know, a couple years ago when they had a harsh winter, they hadn't seen grass, you know, in months. So to be able to come down here and play, it's a really, really good benefit for them as well.
So. All right. Well, Larry, thank you so much for coming on. Before we go to break, tell us one more time, what is the date on CityCon and where can they get tickets?
Sure. January 22nd and 23rd. Right now, they can purchase tickets through our office at the Auburndale Parks and Recreation office. They can call or visit us online. And
vendors can check with you too, as far as being
vendors. Absolutely. Yeah, we're still accepting vendors. We've got a lot of new vendors this year, a lot out of Tampa and the Clearwater area are coming over. So it should be a really good show this year.
All right. Fantastic. Well, Larry, thank you so much. And we're going to go to break and we're going to take a look at some footage from the NSA Youth Fall State. That event is coming up on December 12th and 13th. Check this out. Hank and Neal will be right back here on Sports Central.
We are having our Fall State Championships here with NSA, the National Softball Association. We have 118 teams playing this weekend here in Polk County at four complexes. For each team, there's approximately 12 to 14 players, okay, for each team. And for every team, there's approximately two parents and some grandparents, cousins, sisters, relatives. A lot of people come out to watch fast pitch. So there's a lot of people here. So if you do the math, I think it would be somewhere around 20,000 probably total-ish. We're at Christina Park, Auburndale Raceway, Diamondplex, and Bartow. We have a great relationship with Polk County Sports Marketing. And second of all, Mark Jackson, and we've known him for many, many years. It's a central part of the state, and the fields, the complexes are beautiful. Maintenance is great, so that we've come here for, I think, the last 5 or 6 years, if not longer. Well, I want to have a great weekend. I love the fall. This tournament is the culmination of the fall season, which starts at Labor Day for the fall. All right, it goes until this is normally the last event. I know there are teams from all over the state of Florida here. I mean, covering the whole state. And whoever wins this event can put your hat on this one, because each bracket has about 30 to 35 teams in it. So for you to win that one, you did good.
Everybody, welcome back to Sports Central. Neal Duncan alongside Hank Longo in this third segment brought to us by Hungry Howie's, a great partner of tourism and sports marketing, and some good softball action there, but tis the season. Football is getting into the whole college football playoff mess, and we won't go there because, well, Florida State's lost twice, so I don't really care. but we are getting into basketball season.
And you do look forward to that season.
I do look forward to that, being a Hoosier, Indiana native. But joining us now is Rjay Barsh, the head basketball coach at Southeastern University. And, Coach, welcome to Sports Central.
Thanks for having me back. Excited to be here.
Yeah, entering in your fourth season at the helm at Southeastern, and I have a lot of questions I want to ask because, you know, I'm very passionate about basketball, but tell us first and foremost, someone that doesn't know about Southeastern, what does it mean to go to Southeastern, and what is that experience like as a student?
Southeastern is a Christ-centered campus that really tries to engage students to be leaders in their own communities. And so everyone on our campus is going to get an opportunity to either lead a mission trip, to be a leader in the classroom. And in athletics, we want them to be champions in the court, champions in the classroom, and champions in the community. Mm-hmm. And I think that theme goes throughout the entire campus. So I think when kids and parents choose Southeastern, they're choosing the brand of what an alumni looks like. Mm-hmm. And our alumni do such a great job. Speaking of basketball, Kristen Ledlow, alumni of Southeastern University, who does NBA TV. And so there's so many Southeastern alumni that keep their Christ values in the marketplace or in their career they choose. And I think that's what draws students to Southeastern.
Very good, very good.
Well, it's always fun to talk about what the coach did to get into basketball. You know, for those folks that haven't got to meet you before, what's a little history on your basketball days?
I grew up in Tacoma, Washington. And Tacoma, in the last 15 years, Tacoma, Seattle, has become a hotbed for basketball. I think we got 15 to 20 guys who have made it to the NBA. And so I was growing up in a time where every single gym, basketball is being played. I think you have the shirts that guys used to wear that raised on the concrete. We were always playing basketball, rain, snow, slime, whatever. It didn't matter. We were always playing basketball. I was 12 years old, and I attended a basketball camp. And there's a man by the name of Fred Crowell who was coaching a gym of 200 kids. And when he was coaching that gym, he had the control, and people were responding. And I remember sitting down on the bleachers thinking, man, I want to do that.
Controlling 200 kids. That's a task.
And so I fell in love with the X's and O's. I fell in love with building chemistry. I was always one of those guys that wanted to be the great teammate. I was blessed to have some skills, so I was able to play in college. My freshman year at Tacoma Community College, we won the entire thing for junior college. So having that success early breeds confidence. And being a captain on that team really showed me that I had the leadership skills to become a coach. Wow. Unfortunately for me, my junior year in college at Central Washington, I had a career-ending back injury. And so I wasn't able to fulfill my desires to continue to play. So I started coaching very early. I was 21 on scholarship, and I decided I'd go right into student coaching. And so I started coaching my junior year. I was coaching guys older than me, coaching guys younger than me, and demanded the respect that I saw when I was 12, right? And I just started walking that out. And God's just continued to open up so many doors for me that I don't feel like I'm worthy to have, but I've always stewarded the responsibilities, always try to be humble and not be prideful. And from being at the junior college and having a junior college experience, and then going to a Division II school and having that experience, and then coaching at a D3, and then coaching at a high school. I've had so many experiences in a young coaching career that choosing Southeastern as a place to be for the last 4 years has really helped in the recruiting and all that.
Now let me throw this one in, because I think this is so important for kids that are watching, because you hit the nail right on the head on what I think is a very, because I'm in education, and when you talk to kids about what their dream is, well, I want to be a pro basketball player or a pro football player, and it's like, well, what's your plan B? If you get hurt, and like what you experience, you've got a great career going out, all of a sudden you have a back injury that's taking you out of the game. Now what do I do? And you have found that passion.
Yeah,
what
I tell parents, and because I work with several NBA players, and there's several talents in Lakeland that I'm very close to, I say plan A is education. Because irregardless of your talent, if you make it to the NBA, if you make it to the NFL, you want to be the person who's managing your finances, who's managing your life, and so having an education allows you to do that. So fantastic. Education should never be plan B. And so I always tell them, hey, even if you think you're one and done, we got a couple of guys in our area who have the ability to do that, you still need to make sure that education is plan A. Because you've seen so many guys ruin their careers in their 10th year of a veteran because they hadn't been managing their money. They haven't been managing their nonprofits. So for me, and being from Tacoma, that Seattle area where there's so many NBA guys who have done it wrong, and then there's a handful of guys who are doing it right, I know what right looks like, and those guys who are doing it right have an education. And so that's kind of what I preach to all the young men and young women that are trying to play pro sports.
Well, speaking of those young men, talk to us about your team this year. As I said before, fourth year at the helm at Southeastern. What are the goals this year for the team, and what do you think it's going to take, or what does this team have to take the next step in the program?
I think when a lot of people saw our roster last year, they thought this year would be rebuilding, losing seven guys from last year's team that lost in the conference championship game to number two, Embry-Riddle. We went to your backyard, and we got a kid from IUPUI, Elijah Ray, 6'7", can shoot the three. We also got a kid from Montevello, his name is Linwood Ross. My younger brother, who was supposed to go to Hawaii Hilo, a Division II school, transferred in. And so our school's been known to attract some really high quality guys and talent. This year's team was built, our coaching staff built this team based on the teams we saw when we made our Final Four run. Mm-hmm. We wanted to have 1 through 10 be able to play the game and put the ball on the floor. I think some of the issues we've ran into in the past is we've had guys who could score, but they were specialists. You got to be able to have guys who can put the ball on the floor, especially with the new college basketball rules. Mm-hmm. This hand check, that's a foul. You know, so we wanted to make sure we had guys who could put the ball on the floor and also shoot it. I think we're shooting as a team through three games over 50% from three, taking high quality shots, and guys are able to get to the paint.
Wow.
Well, and then speaking of quality shots, but you just took on a quality opponent, yeah. And really unique situation for a school like Southeastern to be able to travel up to Tallahassee and take on the Seminoles.
Yeah, Coach Hamilton was one of the first guys I reached out to when I got the job in Southeastern. Just because if you're gonna be successful, you got to make sure you respect those who are already doing it right in your area. And Coach Stan Jones, who's the associate head coach there, really has took me under his wing as a mentor, and really just been kind of laying the ground of how to build a successful program. And one of the ways to do that is you got to get your program exposure. Mm-hmm. When I first got to Southeastern, I would tell people it's the world's best hidden secret. And when I have the job, I don't want it to be a secret anymore. I want people to know we exist. I want people to know our brand. I want people to know what we stand for. And so getting games like playing against a Florida State, who right now was a tournament team, I think they're projected as an 8 seed in the first bracket that Lenardi does. Mm-hmm. So when you can take your NAIA program up to Tallahassee and practice in that gym and then play and compete in that game, it's a little easier to play NAIA team. Right. When you're going up against a 7-footer for 40 minutes.
What do your players learn from that experience? I mean, what do they see in these guys playing for Florida State that they need to incorporate into their skill set to get up to a little higher level of playing?
I think there's two ways I can answer that question. The guys who we recruit are guys who don't believe they should be at the NAIA level. They're guys who have the Division I ability, but maybe academically something didn't go their way, so they needed a little more academic help. They're guys who have Division I ability that have decided, you know what, I don't want the rigors of a Division I program. I want to be able to build my relationship with Christ in academics and still play high-level basketball. So we kind of target those guys. So if you look at our roster, I mean, we've got a transfer from Liberty, Division I, two Division I transfers from IUPUI, Division II transfer. So we go and we attract those guys that when we walk into a Florida State, they're not deer in the headlights. They're there to compete. Now, when they have 14 guys on, 15 guys on scholarship, and our roster does not, there comes a point in time where they're an ACC team and we're a Sun Conference team. But to start that game, if you were to watch the first 10 minutes of that game, I mean, we had a 2-point lead, you know, going in, you know, with like 9 or 10 minutes left to go in the first half. So our top six definitely can compete with any team in the country. And we really believe that simply because we can spread the floor out and we can put the ball on the ground.
Is it true after you guys had the 2-point lead, you called timeout and you guys ran off the court?
We tried to do that.
They wouldn't let you do that?
There's something that they had to give me, and they were holding that back if we didn't come back on the floor. Right. So I told our guys, hey, we have to finish this game.
We have to finish.
Don't play the scoreboard.
Well, and it's obvious that you have the mentality, the program gets better, anybody, anytime, anywhere, because, you know, being battle tested is what's going to help you for some of those key games. And looking at the schedule, I've got to think that December 2nd game against Weber, you know, being in close proximity, that's a big game for you guys.
Yeah, it definitely is a big game because the Sun Conference, our league, is so competitive. I mean, every single game, top to bottom, is going to be a battle. It's proven that way my last 3 years. Mm-hmm. And so playing, you want to go 1-0 every single chance you have a league game. And being our first league game, we're usually on the road, so we're glad we get to have that game at home. Mm-hmm. So we're definitely looking forward to that game. But right now, we're just trying to build every single day, go 1-0 every single day, and build on moments. So today, our primary concern is practice at 3:15, and then we have Johnson's of Tennessee coming in tomorrow at 2 p.m.
Must be a head basketball coach thing, because with that answer, I was sworn if I closed my eyes, Terrence McGriff would have been sitting up there. But speaking of Coach McGriff and some of the other coaches in this county, this is a hotbed of talent in high school basketball. How do you guys all play off of each other or help each other? Because I know that goes on. You talk about mentoring through Florida State. Everybody's trying to help everybody.
Well, I've started this thing called Coach Barsh Academy with Troy Wells, and what we've done is we've ran basketball camps all summer. Mm-hmm. We run clinics. We just had a clinic 3 weeks ago at George Jenkins High School, and we allow students from all areas to come in and get real training. Mm-hmm. I think when I first got here, one of the things that Polk County was missing was there wasn't a lot of skills training outside of McGriff. He was doing it with his guys, but there wasn't a lot in the area for those young kids to mature in their development. Mm-hmm. Probably have you seen in Indiana. Mm-hmm. I think the kids here get a football first.
Yeah.
And when you say skills training, what are the skills that you're trying to teach them?
The one thing I'm noticing with Central Florida players is extreme athletes. So we're trying to teach the small fundamentals, jump stop, you know, reverse pivots, head fakes, you know, change of speed, change of direction. All those things that are not innate qualities for a player. I mean, if you can run and jump, that's first base. If you can do those other things, I believe you can hit home runs.
That's funny because you talk about the camp and the skill training. I'll tell you a quick story, and I know we got to go to break, but I was in middle school and went to the Bobby Knight Indiana University basketball camp.
Wow.
You're thinking, I'm going to IU. Bobby Knight. Of course, not necessarily the same atmosphere that you're going to have at Southeastern, but it was the Indiana University basketball camp. You want to know the one time we saw Bobby Knight? He walked in, the opening of the camp, walked in, looked at the campers and said, "Welcome to the Indiana University basketball camp. My name is Bobby Knight. We will not have a problem out of you." He turned around and walked out. That's the last time you saw him.
And there were no problems.
Nobody said a word. So commanding that respect, like you said back there in Washington, somebody controlling the gym, and you certainly seem like you've got that in check at Southeastern. Anything else we need to know about the season?
It's going to be an exciting team. We are looking to score a lot of points. Just be following us on Twitter, SEU or Fire Athletics. Mm-hmm. Donnie Smith does a good job with our SID information. And we want to pack our gym out. We've done a good job in the community with really getting people to respond to our game. So when you see us at the end of every single game, you can come down to center court where we will finish every single game with a prayer and a call for salvation. That's just, like I said in the beginning of the segment, we are Christ-centered campus, and we want to make sure, win or lose, that we have victory every single night.
All right, Coach. Well, good luck this season, and hopefully we'll have you back on talking about a big tournament run.
That'd be great.
Looking forward to that. Heck yeah.
See you guys in March.
All right. Well, we've talked about a lot of great athletes and a lot of great sports in Polk County, and Alex Gilmore, a senior volleyball player from Lakeland High School, is our feature package right here. Hank and Neal will be right back here on Sports Central.
She's one of the best setters that's ever come through this program.
Oh, yeah! It's crazy to think that, like, my past 4 years playing volleyball are just over. For the past 4 years, it's been, like, eat, sleep, volleyball, and then, like, with school on the side. I think the thing I'm going to miss the most is probably my team, just being able to see them every day and getting to laugh with them and just make memories with them. Freshman year, I remember being, I mean, I don't think I was that good, but Crystal would like was super intimidating.
I think a lot of freshmen are intimidated going in, you know, ninth grader, high school, trying out for the volleyball team.
She would like yell at me and I'd have to like fight back the tears.
It didn't take her very long to realize that I'm not that intimidating most of the time.
It's so different going from like super intimidated freshman year to practically one of my like biggest mentors. Well, my junior year, I went in thinking that I was gonna be the second setter with Kristen being first. Then all of a sudden, she like hurt her knee at practice one day. And she texts me that night. She's like, Alex, like, this is it. Like, you're gonna be the setter. It was just very overwhelming at first. But then it got better with Crystal calming me down and Kristen being there by my side, just encouraging me and supporting me the entire time. Well, the setter is seen as like the quarterback on the court. So the fact that I went from being the junior second setter to first setter and a captain, like, it didn't occur to me how big my role was until that year. I was a lot more confident my senior year because of my junior year, mostly because I had built that relationship with Crystal and I knew that Crystal trusted me as a setter.
I chose her as our head captain this year because I had 100% confidence that I felt that she could get the job done, not only on the court, but off the court.
The Jenkins game, whenever we won, the fact that it was 15-13 in the fifth set was kind of like, you could tell I was shaking, and like everybody being there, like the whole crowd, the bleachers were filled. Just the excitement that you felt in the gym and the excitement when we won, we were just all so relieved. The fact that it's been like 4 or 5 years since the last win against Jenkins, it was just a huge accomplishment for all of us. The district championship game was, you could tell we were just having fun. And I think that's like the best part of the game, just being able to have fun with your sisters. So that was probably one of the best games of the season for me. Well, I've always been super involved in my church, The Rock. Even during volleyball season, I would leave early for practices if I needed to so I could get to church on time. Every year we go on this mission trip to Eagle Rock and in Tennessee. We go around and get all the kids in like the different communities up there, and we put on a VBS Monday through Friday. And we just have like fun and games and Bible study and music and puppets, and it's a lot of fun. My parents have been my biggest fans my entire life, whether it's for school or for volleyball, they would build me up to do things. Being a setter, like on the court, I mean, I have that responsibility, but off the court, I mean, I really want to lead people to where they want to go and who they want to be.
The way she represented the team and the program, and she was just so classy and so humble and just loves the school and loved our team, and her and I had a great relationship.
When it comes to Lakeland volleyball, it's all about the sisterhood that we have. I think the fact that I've had such a strong relationship with everybody here, every player that's been able to walk through this gym, that's what I'm going to remember the most about playing volleyball here. Hi, I'm Alex Gilmore, and I'm the setter for the awesome Lakeland Dreadnoughts.
Everybody, welcome back to Sports Central. Neal, Duncan alongside Hank Longo. And
this is so much fun.
We sure haven't done this
for years, and we're back at it, and it's our fourth segment. It's pretty good. We've made it so far.
They didn't turn off the cameras yet.
They didn't turn off
yet,
the camera. And can we thank our sponsor of this for this segment? Blah, 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 blah. We want to give a big thank you to Hall Communications for sponsoring our fourth segment of Sports Central, where we get to talk about all the other fun things going on.
Yeah, of course, 97 Country, Max 98.3, WONN, and Talk 1430 WLKF, and Talk 96.7.
And you get to do a little bit of radio commentary. When do you get to do that? What
day? Yeah, we do Sports Central on LKF Tuesdays from 7 to 8 a.m. and then we hit the other three stations during the 8 o'clock hour, and then the Thursday night version of Sports Central is from 5 to 6 p.m. on Talk 1430 WLKF.
You do a
Talk
great job with
96.7 and yeah. Great partners, just like the partners here at PGTV and, of course, Polk County Board of County Commissioners. We couldn't do it without them. And we couldn't do all this without great events coming into Polk County, and I know we got a great lacrosse event.
Yes,
coming
we
in.
Do. The IWLCA President's Cup, and it's going to take place Saturday, November 21st and Sunday, November 22nd at Lake Myrtle Sports Complex. More than 200 elite high school lacrosse teams coming to play.
Yeah, we already talked about the USSSA Turkey Trot. That'll be Sunday, November 22nd and Monday, November 23rd. And that is a fast pitch softball tournament. More than 70 youth, adult, and senior softball tournaments annually is hosted here by USSSA. So great partners of tourism and sports.
Got a lot of ball going on. Of course, then there's the Rattler Bowl. The Northeast Rattler Bowl is taking place on Friday, November 27th and Sunday, November 29th at the Cook Field in Haines City. It's
football.
A tournament held for a quarter of a century youth football teams, yeah.
Yeah, well, they start early around here in all
they
sports,
do.
And
they
certainly
do.
Football is one of them. Florida Independent Softball Association will present the Florida ISA Youth Toys for Tots event. That's at 555 Park in Bartow. That is Saturday, November 28th, and Sunday, November 29th.
And that's a great event. They do, the ISA does a great job in getting a lot of toys for tots. And,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's nice if you can be a part of that, because there's a lot of kids that need those special gifts that, you know, make a holiday for them.
Well, and remember, this time of year is the season for giving, and it's even better when you give something and people don't know you've done it.
Yeah.
You know, you don't give so people know that you gave.
Yeah,
but if you can help out some youths, go down there, donate to the Toys for Todd drive.
Florida Half Century 60 State Championship, Saturday, December 5th, Sunday, December 6th at the Diamondplex in Auburndale. I'm telling you, folks, for all teams ages 60 and above over the two-day weekend, and more than 50 senior softball teams from across Florida are expected to compete in this end-of-the-season ending tournament, and you can go right into the next event, Mr. Duncan.
I will not say that one of us can play that and one of us cannot.
Yep, and I hope you got your shoes and you do real well. Don't forget to grease up your mitt there, buddy.
Florida Independent Softball Association has a lot of events going on, especially in December. The 5th and 6th, they will also be hosting the Youth See Fall States. So that is at Bartow 555. Check that out.
All these ISA events, I tell you, they've got a lot going on, and so does the National Softball Association with their NSA Youth Fall State Tournament, and that's going to take place Saturday, December 12th and the 13th. Diamondplex, just tons.
This is money coming into our community and through our leisure travel, as well as our sporting events. And this is the reason why we don't pay. It's getting ready. We're going to turn the calendar, and you're going to get those W-2s in the mail, and you're not going to have any state income tax there. And this is the reason for it. It's tourism and sports in the state.
Just the great economic impact that these teams have coming into our community. Now, get away from softball a little bit and talk about the City of Lakeland hosting the Lakeland Winter Sectional on Saturday, January 9th. Through the 12th at the Bierman Family Tennis Complex. Mm-hmm. So some great tennis also takes place here in beautiful Polk County. It's a United States Tennis Association, Florida sponsored and sanctioned tennis tournament featuring only the top ranked players in the state. So great opportunity to see some of our great youth tennis players.
Yeah, you can go to ustaflorida.com for more information on that event. And I'll tell you what, that is, we were talking to Larry about the Auburndale Tennis Center, but that Bierman Sports
facility is fantastic.
Absolutely, absolutely. Universal Shooting Academy, January 15th through the 17th, will be hosting the Florida State Pistol Championships. And of course, we want to make a mention every time we can about Frank Garcia and his partners down there at the Universal Shooting Academy in Frostproof. We partnered last year to bring the World Shoot, but the economic impact of that facility, of Universal Shooting Academy, continues to generate $38 for Polk County.
And it just is another unique venue that we have to offer. I mean, just something, you know, different than your basketball, football, and as you mentioned, world championships here last year. It's
absolutely. The Florida State Soccer Association presents the FSSA Florida Classic. Now, this is not the Florida Youth Soccer Association. This is the Florida State Soccer Association, which is the adults. So that's the over 18 individuals. It's a premier winter event, 11v11 adult soccer tournament. Of course, that is going to be at the Lake Myrtle Sports Park, and that is January 15th through the 18th.
We've got a lot of softball going on, I'm telling you. Once again, ISA, Saturday, January 16th through Sunday at the Bartow Park. Expects more than 450 participants. Boy, that's a lot of folks coming in to play ball.
Absolutely. And don't forget the Auburndale Speedway will be presenting the Sunoco Triple 50 Pro Late Model Race on Sunday, January 17th. Some changes have been made out there. The Auburndale Speedway, they're doing some great stuff out there. So check that out and be looking for other events that they're working on. Hopefully we'll make some announcements on that. You can go to auburndalespeedway.net for more information about what they have going on there. And Hank, I want to take a moment to talk about, we announced it some time ago, we've been in the works for it, but we got a couple minutes here. The Florida Sports Hall of Fame, moving from the Lake Myrtle Sports Park to the Visitor Information Center up in Davenport. We got probably about 60 seconds to talk about where are we at on that project and where are we going.
Very exciting. Glad that you should ask. We have designed the new Florida Sports Hall of Fame museum that's at the Visitor Center up on 27 and just south of I-4, Polk County's Visitor Center. We have designed the whole museum. Now we have taken the whole museum down and are refurbishing the theater, putting in new floors, painting it, and adding more lights for the exhibits. And we're in the process of starting that on Monday. Actually, Monday night, I'll be there all evening with the carpet guys as we rip out the carpet and get ready to seal the floor for the new floors that we're putting in, and gonna get this thing rocking. And in a few weeks, hopefully, we're gonna be showing off our new Florida Sports Hall of Fame.
Yeah, and the neat thing about that is we've also signed through the Board of County Commissioners a long-term deal for the Florida Sports Hall of Fame to be located right here in Polk County. So they're gonna be here for quite a while, and it adds another attraction for visitors coming into Polk County to visit the Visitor Information Center to get their discounted attraction tickets and the like, but very excited to have them locked up.
It's gonna be just a very neat experience for those people going into the Visitor Center, probably not expecting to find the Hall of Fame there, but it fits so beautifully in the area that used to be the theater. And when you've got just some of the world's most phenomenal athletes displayed in this museum, I think the people are really gonna dig it.
So by the first of 2016, or somewhere in January, we'll open that up, and then we'll be opening up the Polk County Sports Hall of Fame at the Lake Myrtle Sports Park. So exciting stuff going on, exciting sponsors.
We got some great sponsors, and love you, couldn't have the show without you. Harry's Old Place, Sunsplash Vacation Homes, Ovations, Country Club of Winter Haven, and Brout House Networks. Thank you so very much.
We want to remind everybody, if you want to tune into the radio version of Sports Central, you can do it Tuesday mornings from 7 to 8 a.m. on Talk 1430 WLKF and Talk 96.7, or a Thursday from 5 to 6 p.m. on those same stations. We'd also like to remind you to go to CentralFloridaSports.com or VisitCentralFlorida.org for a full listing of events. And that VisitCentralFlorida.org website, brand new, looks terrific.
Oh, wow, yes, the unveiling of that last week was just fantastic. And that whole staff, Chris Keprios and his whole crew, have done a remarkable job.
Absolutely. The next edition of Sports Central will be Friday, December 4th. Until then, you can check out the re-airs of this program, the following dates and times. For Hank Longo, I'm Neal Duncan. We appreciate you tuning in to Sports Central, and we will catch you again next time.